Samuel Taylor Coleridge once wittily summed up the art of poetry as the best words in the best order. A simple definition, but an effective one. Poetry is the act of arranging words in their finest arrangement, revealing truth through structure. Not many people are into poetry today, unless, of course, that poetry is sung. Pop music is the poet's last popular refuge. The form forces formality. Even in these popular pieces, the basic rules of poetry must be followed. The artist must write lyrics that flow with the tune. Even pop music must follow prosody. Everyone knows about rhyme, but it's prosody that forms the beat of poetry. The lyric, the cadence, the beat that you dance to. There are three basic forms of verse: syllabic, accentual, and accentual-syllabic. The first of these, syllabic, is based on a fixed number of syllables per line. Now, syllabic verse isn't that common in English language poetry, because English is a stress-timed language. English words all have a clear-cut cadence. And so it's much more common in non-stress-timed languages, most famously in the Japanese haiku. Even in Kyoto, while hearing the cuckoo's cry, I long for Kyoto. Accentual verse is far more common in English. Its structure comes from a fixed number of accents per line. Beowulf was written in accentual verse, 4 accents per line. Thus made their mourning the men of Geatland, for their heroes passing, his hearth companions. Quoth that of all the kings of earth, of men he was mildest and most beloved, to his kin the kindest, keenest for praise. It's also the form of nursery rhymes, 1 accent per line. Rich man, poor man, beggar man, thief, doctor, lawyer, merchant, chief, tinker, tailor, soldier, sailor, gentleman, apothecary, plowboy, thief. Now compare this piece of accentual verse, 3 accents per line.
Here come old flat top, he come, grooving up slowly, he got juju eyeball, he won, holy roller, he got hair down to his knee. Got to be a joker, he just do what he please.
Or this sage advice, 5 accents per line.
For well you know that it's a fool who plays it cool by making his world a little colder.
The third form, accentual syllabic verse, is the most common in English language poetry, and often the most difficult to write. This verse has a fixed number of accents and syllables. In this form of verse, meters are broken into feet, that is, units of accents. Let's start with the common one, the trochee. Trochee, 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 dun 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 dun. This can occur in any number of contexts, often assertive and proud, such as declaring heroes. Beat the clear and sunny water, beat the shining big sea water, there the wrinkled old Nokomis nursed the little Hiawatha. Recoiling in fear, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore, quoth the raven, nevermore. Declaring joy. You'll notice that some of those feet will have dangling at the end. That's called a catalectic, an incomplete line. It's surprisingly common. Where were we? Oh yes, trochee. Swooning.
I've seen a face, I can't forget the time or place that we just met. She's just the girl for me, and I want all the world to see we've met.
Ooh. Pleading.
Is there anybody going to listen to my story? All about the girl who came to stay.
Sneering.
Friday night I wrapped about a suitcase. Sunday morning creeping like a nun.
And declaring universal love.
I am he as you are, he as you are me, and we are all together.
The opposite of the trochee is the I am. I am, I am, I am, da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. More lilting than the forceful trochee, this is the meter of natural English speech, and it's used throughout the canon. But soft, what light through yonder window breaks? Come live with me and be my love, and we shall all the pleasures prove. To strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. In Xanadu did Kublai Khan a stately pleasure dome decree. 'Twas Brillig and the slithy tomes at Gyre and Gibble in the wave. Because I could not stop for death, he kindly stopped for me. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain.
Why don't we do it in the road?
There are more examples of this. Course.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog.
And
when I was younger, so much younger than today,
I never needed anybody's help in any way.
Part of the power of the IM is the natural sound flow it creates. The two beats that make an IM are perfect for capturing the profundity of the everyday.
I read the news today, oh boy, about a lucky man who made the grade. And though the news was rather sad, well, I just had to laugh.
Of course, poetry doesn't always follow that strict pattern, and it shouldn't. Otherwise, every poem would just be this endless march to a beat. Just 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. There's nothing wrong with putting two left feet forward. And did those feet, in ancient time, walk upon England's mountains green? That switch is called an irregular foot, and it adds some variety to the meter. There are also two other kinds of meter that can't hold a poem by themselves, but can rather be substituted for feet in order to vary the rhythm. The spondee and the ferus. Two accented beats, two non-accented beats. They're very common. Like in this famous piece, Iambic Pentameter, full of dangling catalectics, irregular feet, and both spondaic and pheric feet. To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing envy. It shakes up that otherwise strict formula and turns its march into a frenzy, to show the mind of a suicidal man, or to show the mind of man under the influence.
Turn off your mind, relax, and flow downstream. It's not dying. It's not dying.
IM and the trochee, though common, are only two forms of metrical feet. They're what we call disyllabic feet, two beats. And they're very common in English because they work for English. Unlike, say, tetrasyllabic feet, four beats, which are more common in Greek and Latin poetry. Iridescent throned Aphrodite, deathless, child of Zeus, wild weaver, I now implore you. Though it does occasionally appear in English verse.
So I lit a fire. Isn't it good, Norwegian wood?
Finally, the trisyllabic meters. Three beats to a foot, as you can guess. The most common of trisyllabic meters is the dactyl. It's basically a waltz. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. This is the forest primeval, the murmuring pines and the hemlocks. And
there's not to make reply, there's not a reason why, there's but to do or die. Into the valley of death rode the 600.
It's quite a rhythm. It's a lilting dance.
Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies.
A shy plea.
What would you think if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me?
And a melancholy meditation.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in a church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream.
There's also the reverse of the dactyl, the anapest. Not da-da-da-da-da-da, but da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. The Assyrian came down like a wolf on the fold, and his cohorts were gleaming in purple and gold. Of course, it's far better known for its use in much less violent contexts. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring. Not even a mouse. And speaking of Christmas, oh, and what happened then? Well, in Whoville, they say that the Grinch's small heart grew 3 sizes that day. It's less common in music, but it still occasionally pops up.
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be true.
There are other less common forms of trisyllabic meter, like the cretic. Dum-da-dum, dum-dum-dum.
Let it be.
Or the amphibrach, da 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 da.
I look at you all, see the love there that's sleeping.
And the trisyllabic version of the spondee, the molossus, 3 accented beats.
She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah.
But the important thing to remember about meter is that it's not always needed. All language has rhythm, and poetry need not attach itself to any one beat. Hence the existence of free verse, which jumps from one rhythm to the next, building on all possible beats. I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked. It's not the strict beats of older poetry, but the free rhythm of everyday speech and all of its dancing. This poetry doesn't rest on rhythm, but on the sensations it creates in the reader. I sing the body electric. The armies of those I love engirth me, and I engirth them. They will not let me off till I go with them, respond to them, and discorrupt them, and charge them full with the charge of the soul. What I'm illustrating isn't advanced, nor is it complex. All that I'm saying is that poetry is more common and more accessible than you may think. Poetry is the best words in the best order, and the structures and traditions of poetry are surprisingly ubiquitous. So revel in the beauty of language wherever you see it, in the oldest tomes, or in the songs that you've heard over and over again. Revel in the words of Sappho, Shakespeare, Poe, Longfellow, Tennyson, Coleridge, Dickinson, Carroll, Byron, Blake, Whitman, Ginsberg, and yes, even Lennon, McCartney, Harrison, and Starr.
Living is easy with eyes closed. Misunderstanding all you see. It's getting hard to be someone, but it all works out. It doesn't matter much to me. Let me take you down, 'cause I'm going to strawberry fields. Nothing. Nothing to get hung about. Strawberry fields forever. Strawberry fields forever.